the Mr. Excel podcast is sponsored by Easy Excel. WorkExcel for Mr. Excel podcast episode 1743, address of the previously selected cell. I have to tell you, I love doing the Mr. Excel podcast. Get some really interesting questions and get to think about things that you've never really thought about before. Today's question is sent in by Ams A from YouTube. I was wondering if you can help me. How can I make VBA to track the address of the previous active cell? For example, my cell was A1 and then I click on B1. I need to get cell address as A1 stored in some, and I could never get to the rest of this comment, by the way, so I don't know what the rest of the question was, but we want to be able to store where we were previously. So check this out. I have it working. Like right now I'm in cell G1, and then I'm going to go click in another cell, and the previous cell is recording where I just was. All right, now where are we going to store this information? That's the big question. And what I decided to do, and I actually did this with the macro recorder turned on, so I'm going to record a macro, just how to store text in name. How to store text in name, we'll go to the formulas tab and we define a name. We'll just call the name testing, and we'll say that this is equal to in quotes hello. Click OK and we'll stop recording. And then I went and looked at that code. So how to store text in a name, edit. All right, and it turns out, so they're doing a names.add and refers to R1C1 is equal to double quote. That's the way to put a quote inside of a quote. So here's this whole string here is a quoted string. Anytime inside of here that you want to put a single quote, you have to put two quotes. All right, and they're also doing something with a comment. And none of this really felt right to me. Because I don't want to add the name, I just want to be able to store the value in the name. But this gave me enough information that we're dealing with, you know, something called names. And so I kind of just came down here and did sub test some more and active workbook dot names testing. All right, and right here, once I hit this dot, they're going to give me a list of all of the properties of that name. And sure enough, there's something called refers to. Refers to local would be in the local language. Refers to R1C1, that's not what we want here. We want to just do refers to. And so let's do debug.print. All right, so this is cool. This is, you know, I've been doing VBA, oh my gosh, almost 20 years. But I don't work with names enough to know, you know, what I needed. But by doing activeworkbook.names, the parentheses and then the dot, the IntelliSense or autocomplete, let's call it autocomplete, gives me the list of possible entries. So we'll run that macro here and we'll see what we get. And from, you know, that little test, I think, there we go. So inside the refers to property, they're storing hello. That means that if I have a name defined, I can use this refers to hold things and to get them back later. All right, so the next steps here, I came out and I defined a name just like I did for testing, but I created names called last cell and prior cell, and I initially just set them to hello like I did with testing. So you have to set up last cell, prior cell. Actually, I ended up using cur cell for current cell and prior cell. So those are the two you really need. You don't need this one. You don't need last cell. And you don't need our testing that I did. So set up two name ranges using formulas define name. Just set them to hello. All right. Then we're going to come to VBA. So that's Alt F11. In VBA, you're going to look at the Project Explorer. In the Project Explorer, if you don't see that, go to View Project Explorer or Control R. Look for the sheet. Double click the sheet. This will initially start out blank. I need you to go up here and select Worksheet from the top left drop down. The right drop down immediately changes to Selection Change. All right, so we're going to have two names, one called Cur Cell, one called Prior Cell. The second line of code is going to say the current cell is equal to the target.address. That's the cell that we just selected, the current cell, and we're going to wrap that in quotes. All right, so this is kind of wild here. We start out with an equal sign, and then a single quote is represented by two quotes. close that initial string. So right there we have an equal and a quote, ampersand target.address, and then these four quotes here is a way of putting a quote inside of another quote. But that's really confusing. Four quotes will get you one quote. And so that will store the address of the current cell in this name. And before we do that, we're going to say the prior cell is equal to the current cell. So before we record the new current cell, we're going to take that value that was stored in the current cell and move it over to the prior cell. And now it all just works. These formulas here are really simple. Equal prior cell. It even kind of shows up there in the list. Press tab. Equal cur cell. Tab. And it all works. Now I started to think about this. I actually wrote this macro last night, and as I started to record it, it's like, why does he want this information? Why does he want to know the last cell he was in? Maybe he's trying to figure out if something just changed in that cell. So I'm going to control tab here to another workbook called Podcast 1743A, where I created two more variables, cval and pval. So it shows the current cell is J2, the previous cell is J3. And what I think is cool is this is the value when I initially selected J3, and this is the value now. The value now is the indirect, but these are those two new variables that I set up, cval and pval. And so let's come here and select MNO, and we'll put in XYZ. Press Enter. All right, so now the current cell is J3, but the previous cell was J2. It was MNO when I selected it, and now it's XYZ. Isn't that a cool little bit of functionality? Using names, not to store cells or anything like that, just to store an actual value, some text, and that text happens to be the address. The code to make the previous value and current value work, very similar. I just copied those two lines down, pval and cval. The only big change here is before, where I was storing target.address, I'm now storing target.value. Interesting note, these top two lines of code would have worked if I selected a range. These will only work when I select single value, so a little bit more work would have to be done if you really wanted to get just the first cell of the selected range. Well, hey, all right, I want to thank you for stopping by. We'll see you next time for another Netcast. Mr. Excel.